make sure a few of them are dirt. I am like a drop of water on a rock. After drip, drip, dripping in the same place, I begin to leave a mark, and I leave my mark in many people's hearts. Welcome to worship. We're grateful that you have chosen to be with us this morning as we continue to live into ordinary time. It's a time when we take our faith and move with it and allow it to move us and shape us and guide us. We have received the blessing of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, and now this long stretch of time in the church, ordinary time, is when we do the work, when we embody the Spirit, when we connect with Jesus and model our lives after His, saying the things that He said, doing the things that He did. And so we offer you a warm welcome, because that's what Jesus is about, welcoming people, knowing them, encouraging them to the truth that they belong, giving gifts of peace to one another. And so we invite you to feel that peace of Christ, to feel that Holy Spirit in you and swirling around you, to feel God's peace in creation and in memories and in dreams and hopes for tomorrow. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Thank you.
Our first scripture lesson this morning is from Matthew 7. Jesus said, "Anyone who hears and obeys these teachings of mine is like a wise person who built a house on rock. Rain poured down, rivers flooded, and winds beat against that house, but it did not fall, because it was built on solid rock. Anyone who hears my teachings and doesn't obey them is like a foolish person who built a house on sand. The rain poured down, the rivers flooded, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Finally, it fell with a crash." Please pray with us. Holy One, indeed, we want to, need to, rely on you, lean on you. And so we come this morning to clear a pathway so that we can be connected with you in deep and abiding ways. So give us clarity and wisdom, patience and power to remove those obstacles. If just for now, as we make ourselves vulnerable, available to you as you express yourself in creation, to you as you express yourself in Jesus, to you as you express yourself to us in the Holy Spirit, limitless Holy Spirit. Help us truly, O God, to be present in this moment, receiving blessing and encouragement, correction, guidance, and grace beyond measure. Amen. Well, you may have noticed my based on a drawing that a young girl named Mallory, who was 12, drew. And you probably can see the tools on there. And I brought with me a few other tools today. Maybe some of you work with tools. Maybe some of you play with tools. Maybe some of you build things or fix things, repair things. That's one of my favorite things about these tools, that you can use them to get work done, to fix something, build something from nothing. And you can also use them to kind of repair or fix, not just the things, but the mistakes that you made when you were doing that work or that building or that repair. And I like to think about these tools as one of the ways that we can think about how God gives us second, third, fourth, fifth chances, that we make mistakes. All people make mistakes. And that just like these tools, God gives us the ability to try again, to ask for forgiveness, to try a new way, to ask for help, to try things a little bit differently than we did before. And so on Father's Day, there are some who are receiving gifts of tithes. There are some who are thinking about fixing or repairing or building something. There are stories being told. There's laughter. And there are tears today. Whenever there's a holiday or a holy day, sometimes there's great joy, people gathering together, and sometimes there's a bit of sadness because of someone who is not there or because of someone who has died. And so we listen to each other, we love each other on days such as this, and we think about the things that we can do and the things that we can fix, the things that we can repair, the things that we can try again about. Please pray with us. God, we thank you for the gift of tools, for the gift of family, for the gift of parents, for the gifts of one another. Help us in all of these things to learn from our mistakes and to celebrate the things that we do well. Help us, O God, to listen to each other and to grow in love all of our days. Amen. Jesus always had a story. He had a story flowing and brewing in him all the time. You might remember that last Sunday, one of the passages that we read when we were outside was this. With many stories like these, Jesus presented his message to all the people, fitting the stories to their experience and maturity. He was never without a story when he spoke. When he was alone with his disciples, he went over everything, sorting out the tangles, untying the knots. So we have a number of scripture stories to share with you today. It's a mix of stories, but there's something that they have in common, and that is the stone or a rock that's part of the story. We wanted to group these stories to be some kind of a theme. And we suggested that you bring a stone or a rock to help you connect with these stories, and so that later we can experience a ritual together with a rock. And if you don't have one, don't worry about it. You can grab something else to substitute for that rock. You might even just crinkle up a piece of paper so that that is your rock. As I mentioned earlier, we are now in ordinary time, and so it's time to be the church. It's time to be the expression of Jesus in the world. And And so we have to remember what it is that Jesus said and did, and how it was that he continued to learn and grow, and what he did when things weren't going well, what he did when there needed to be repair or forgiveness or trying a new way. And so we gather with some of these stories that Jesus would have known, would have been told as a child, and then some of these stories that have Jesus involved in it, the way that he was interacting with people, the things that he said and did. And so we're imagining today on Father's Day that these stories belong to all of us. And as people of faith, as people who express their faith through Christianity, we're saying that these stories are a part of our story. They're a part of our family. They helped us to become who we are. And they teach us and they guide us and they encourage us. And so we're listening to these stories to figure out how to live, how to move forward, how to take this history, this movement of the people who have gone before us, including Jesus and the disciples, into this ordinary time of being the church, of living our faith in old and new ways, in ways that encourage us and calm us, in ways that kind of stir us up, or maybe push or poke or prod us a little bit to do things that maybe we hadn't intended to do, that we're not even sure that we're able to do, but we can try, and we can try again to be faithful, to be this gospel, this good news, this love story in the world. And so as you move forward with us in these stories, you might find that you share these values and the things that are highlighted. Maybe because they were planted in you by your family of origin. Or maybe that was not a setting where this kind of teaching and nurture and encouragement happened. And so instead, you are intentionally choosing these stories to be yours. Maybe they weren't inherited, but they are intentionally your stories now as you go ahead. And maybe you have or need to find some support professionally to help you look back at some of the stories of your family of origin so that you can get what you need from them to be able to move forward, to be more available to how God wants you to move into the future. And so God will help us to find truth and guidance in these words. So I want to go back to that first story that we shared this morning about Jesus saying, anyone who listens to me is like someone who builds their house on rock. Someone who doesn't listen to me is like someone who builds their house on sand. Because whether your house is built on rock or sand, the winds will come, the rains will come, the waves will come, because they come to all of us. But if we are firmly built, if layer after layer we've been listening to the Spirit, we've been modeling ourselves after Jesus, if we have been bathing in God's creation, if we've been trusting God and listening to God and praying and being open and available, then we'll be sturdy, we'll be strong. Those waves and the wind are going to keep coming, but we'll be strong, we'll be steady, we'll be prepared. Rains will pour, floods will come, but we will be ready, we will be prepared. It's a bit like maybe Jesus was convincing himself too, because he knew what he was going to be up against soon. And I like to imagine that he was saying, if there is a time in your house, in your life, in your spirit, when the water gets in, when things become a little bit difficult, then maybe you can do some repairing of that spot, of that space, by yourself or with others, just always being prepared and ready and faithful and sturdy and strong. Our next story comes from Genesis. Jacob left Beersheba and went towards Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to heaven. And the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and to your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth. And you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And all the families of the world will be blessed in you and in your offspring. Know that I am with you. and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning, and he took the stone that he had put under his head and set it up for a pillar and poured oil on the top of it. He called that place Bethel, but the name of the city was Luz at the first. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and clothing to wear, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God, and this stone which I have set up for a pillar shall be God's house, and all that you give me, I will surely give one-tenth to you. Remember where we've come from. Even if it wasn't a nurturing, safe place, maybe we need to rewrite our story. Maybe we need to claim what Jacob claimed in this story, and that truth is that God is in this place, whatever place that might be. Jacob was not at home. Jacob was using a rock for a pillow. He surely was not comfortable. He was in a bit of turmoil. But he sensed, because he was able to listen, that God was in that place. And he celebrated that truth, and that can be a truth for us. That God is in whatever place that we are in. God is always out ahead of us, preparing places for us. God is always ready to meet us where we are. This God who is never separate from us. This can be our story, that we feel and sense that truth, that God is in this place. Whatever place it is that we are in, God is in this place. Be sure of this.
Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but God in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it.
So Jesus is telling Peter that he will be the church. And as we imagine what the church is, we might imagine the church is healing, the church is hope, the church is refreshment. The church is a place where we can be ourselves, where we can bring our whole selves. The church is a place that recognizes hungers and thirsts and meets those hungers and quenches those thirsts. The church is a place where we can belong, where we can be known by name, where we can take our foibles and take our frustrations and give them over to the holy, and give them over to the community, and instead be given grace and peace and power. So this Peter, you remember, Peter is the one who denied Jesus three times during that holy week, those last few days of Jesus' life. And Jesus knew that. And yet he said to Peter, upon you I will build my church. Jesus gives us opportunities over and over again. Jesus separates us from our past when things are difficult, when we have made mistakes, when we have betrayed or denied. Jesus says, even on you, I will build the church. Even on you, I will feed the hungry and clothe the naked, help people to feel belonging, to feel cherished, to feel honored. You are a part of what God is about to do next. The next thing that God is going to do might just come through you. And so we remember in this story to be available. and to let our past fade back and to be what church is going to be next, to be what God is about to build and do next, because God is always doing a new thing, and we have a part to play in that. We have a role to play in that. Our next story is from Matthew 28. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here, for he has been raised. As he said, come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples." Well, in this story, it's Easter morning, and the impossible is suddenly not only possible, but real. What they didn't think could happen actually happened. The women went to the tomb. They knew that that great stone had been rolled in front of the tomb. They didn't know how they would move it, but they believed that somehow they would gain access to that space so that they could anoint Jesus with oils and perfumes to perform a ritual, a tradition of honoring and cherishing the body that the Spirit had lived in, giving thanks for the humanity that we all have and hold. And so from this story, we might learn to show up. To show up even when things seem impossible. Even when grief is weighing us down, show up and know that God is about to do a new thing. And maybe God's new thing will be done right in front of you. And your eyes will be opened. And the impossible will not only seem possible, but will become real. And you will see miracle. And you will be available to lift yourself out from under that rock of grief, from that separation, and be in fullness of God's grace and God's miracles, and be in wonder.
Next reading is from First Book of Samuel. Now the Philistines gathered their armies for battle, and there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armored with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and his shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistines said, "Today I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man that we may fight together." When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now Saul and they and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah, fighting with the Philistines. David rose early in the morning, left someone in charge of the sheep, took the provisions, and went as Jesse had commanded him. He came to the encampment as the army was going forth to the battle line, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines drew up for battle, army against army. David left the things in charge of the keeper of the baggage, ran to the ranks, and went and greeted his brothers. As he talked with them, the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, came up out of the ranks of the Philistines and spoke the same words as before, and David heard him. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth. And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, since he has defied the armies of the living God. David said, the Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will save me from the hand of this Philistine. So Saul said to David, go, and may the Lord be with you. Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them. So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in his shepherd's bag in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David, with his shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field. But David said to the Philistine, you come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand. When the Philistine drew nearer to meet David, David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone and slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell, face down, on the ground.
Whoa! So that's actually the lectionary passage for today. That story in our 3-year cycle of readings is for today. And so you can imagine how important it is for us to read the stories, even the ones that we would rather not, even the ones that come to us, the stories of our past or our people that are not so clean and fresh and bright, ones that kind of repel us or make us fearful. And so we shared this story with you in its entirety because it's real and raw. We're sorry for the violence. We know that violence, unfortunately, is real then and now. And so we go through these experiences. We have these scenarios and these stories in our lives, and we try to look at them and look for the truth in them. Many truths in each story. Many stories have truths in them. And so many people read this story and say it's the upside-down world. It's like the upside-down world of the gospel that Jesus brought. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. And those who are hungry will be fed, and those who are satisfied will be without and experience hunger themselves. And so this story becomes upside down because it is the young one who was not fit for battle, who was actually tripping over his armor, the young one who took a small, smooth stone from the river. It was the mustard seed, if you will, who was able to accomplish incredible things that people thought could never happen. And so we can get a lot out of this story, but one thing we might get out of this story is that we are people who have gifts from God and who are able to stand up against formidable things, to rise above where we have been, to take what we have been given, the gifts that are ours, the experiences that we have had, and put them to use so that there can be freedom, so that there can be movement, so that there can be space for each other. And so we push against this idea of exceptionalism. We push against this idea of taking more than what we need. We push against this idea of systems and things that seem too much for us to come against. You can't fight City Hall. Instead, we hear Jesus saying to us, you are enough. You are the thing that is about to unfold. You are the one that's partnering with God to be about a new day. And you can help forward God's agenda of love and justice and peace. And so this story is a difficult one to hear. It's difficult for us to be in those places of violence and unrest and bullying and posturing. And so we need to find a new way forward, a way where we can rely on what God has given us to be a new day. This story becomes our story if we are moved to stand up and to do what we can to fight the forces, that are moving against the dreams and the visions and the hopes of the holy. Our next story is from the Gospel of John. It's early in the morning again. Early in the morning he came to the temple. All the people came to Jesus and he sat down and began to teach them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And making her stand before all of them, they said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery. Now in the law of Moses, it commands us to stone such women. Now what do you say?" They said this to test Jesus, so that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And once again, he bent down and wrote on the ground. When they heard it, they went away, one by one, beginning with the elders. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus straightened up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, sir." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way, and from now on, do not sin again." Somewhere else in the scriptures, Jesus said, "Tend to the log that is in your eye. Tend to the log that is in your own eye before you point out a speck, tiny speck that is in the eye of someone else." God holds up a mirror to ourselves so that we can see our actions. God holds up this mirror so that we can have a sense of who we are in the world, how we interact with each other, the things that we say and do, the things that we don't say, the things that we don't do. And God encourages us always to be a vehicle of grace for one another, because we're all in this together, and we recognize that we all make mistakes, that we all have limitations, that we all have pasts, that we all have fears and frustrations, we all have shadow sides, we all have things that we wish we had not done, we all have things that we said that we'd like to take back. We all find our way to being those who are outside of the path, who have forgotten to love our neighbor as ourselves, who forget to honor and cherish creation, who forget to follow the Ten Commandments and the other spaces and places of guidance that Jesus has given us. We forget to be open and available to the Holy Spirit. And so Jesus is telling the people and telling us in this story, our story, don't throw rocks at people. Don't judge people. Don't shame people. Just love people. Let your rocks drop to the ground and walk even when something seems very clear to you about how a punishment is needed. Try to find places of grace, even in the midst of that difficulty, even in the midst of those things that seem very simple to judge. Where is the space for grace? Where can love soften those edges? How can God do a new thing through you so that the story of difficulty and challenge doesn't continue, but instead finds a new trajectory, a new direction, new possibilities?
Next reading is from 1 Kings. Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, "So may the gods do to me, and more also, if I do not make your life like the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then he was afraid. He got up and fled for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah. He left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a solitary broom tree. He asked that he might die. "It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the broom tree and fell asleep. Suddenly an angel touched him and said to him, "Get up and eat." He looked, and there at his head was a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. He ate and drank and lay down again. The angel of the Lord came a second time, touched him and said, "Get up and eat, otherwise the journey will be too much for you." He got up, ate, and drank. Then he went into the strength of that food for 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mount of God. And at that place, he came to a cave and spent the night.
Hot cakes, baked on stones. Elijah was running for his life. He was unsure of what would happen next. He was exhausted, and he basically was giving up. He wanted to lay down under that tree and say, "Enough." But instead, God met him in that fear. God met him in that running away. God followed him with goodness and mercy all the days of his life, and God made it so that there were fresh, hot cakes baked on stones and a jar of water right there in the middle of nothing, so that he would have the nurture that he needed. Not just once, but twice. Because again, God is the God of second chances, and on, 70 times 7 and more. God meets us in our hungers and in our thirsts. God follows us, again, chases us with goodness and mercy all the days of our lives. That's one of God's promises. That's one of the promises that we bring with our stories from the past. And so God provides a place of nurture again and again for us. God invites us to stop running. God invites us instead to stop and to notice where nurture is being prepared for us, uniquely for us, meeting us right where we are. And we wake up, and we can see that, and we can taste that, and we can have exactly what we need so that we can move forward. And so get up and drink more than once. Receive those gifts. Receive blessings from your stories, your inherited stories, your intentional stories. Set aside the ones that seem to block you from living God's dream and God's vision, from being a new thing, from doing a new thing, from being a part of that movement of Jesus through the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We hope that you felt and heard something, that a story might have a deeper place in you, that you might be able to find your own ways to share these stories with others, with these words, or with your own words, with your own experiences, with your own sensitivities, with your own grace and wisdom, with your own hope and healing. It is our hope that on this day of storytelling, on this day of looking back and looking forward, you will feel encouraged. You will feel blessed. You will feel like you are in the flow of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We invite you to join us in this litany for Father's Day. It is from Rob McCoy and has been adapted for our use today. For fathers everywhere who have given us life and love, that we may show them respect and care.
Holy God, hear this prayer for our fathers.
For fathers who have lost a child through death, that their faith may give them hope, and their family and friends support and console them.
Holy God, hear this prayer for our fathers that mourn.
For men who may or may not have children of their own, but act like a father to someone in need of advice, support, nurture, and love.
Holy God, hear this prayer for our father figures.
For stepfathers who have loved the children of another as their own and created a new family.
Holy God, hear this prayer for stepfathers.
For adoptive fathers who have heard the call of God to lovingly step forward for those who need their care.
Holy God, hear this prayer for adoptive fathers.
For fathers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to the needs of their children, and have not sustained their families.
Holy God, have mercy on absentee fathers.
For fathers who struggle with temptation, violence, or addiction, for those who do harm, and for those whom they have harmed.
Holy God, have mercy on fathers and families that struggle.
For new fathers full of hope, for longtime fathers full of wisdom, for the fathers yet to be, and fathers soon to be.
Holy God, hear our prayer for the fathers of our church.
For those that have shaped our lives without claim of family or kinship, for those who have taught us, guided us, shaped us, and molded us into Christ's disciples.
Holy God, hear our prayer for the fathers of our faith.
God, our parent, in your wisdom and love, you made all things. Bless these men, that they may be strengthened as fathers. Let what we learn from them about faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their daughters and sons, honor them always with a spirit of profound respect, even if that is complicated. Grant this through your Spirit. Amen. So we want to invite you to take out that rock, if you have one, or that rock substitute, and to just kind of look at it and hold it in your hand for a minute, and we're going to think through some of the challenges that people face. This is Pride Month, and so we are uniquely aware of some of the challenges that some people face when they are trying to be themselves, when they're looking for acceptance, when they're looking to be cherished, to belong, to be given the same respect and space that everyone deserves and needs. And so we think about a rock as a stumbling block. Sometimes rocks are put in people's path intentionally so that they will trip up, so that they will not have an easy way. You know about sticks and stones and how they hurt people. You know about stones that Jesus talked about, a millstone wrapped around someone's neck that is thrown in the water. Sometimes stones weigh us down so much that we feel underwater, we feel crushed of spirit. We feel like we cannot move at all. We think about rock walls that separate people. We think about rocks that keep us trapped in a lonely space, separated from the rest of the world. And so we want to be about stones in very different ways. You might remember in Scripture that Moses is told by God to hit the rock and water gushes forth from it, the water that the people needed to drink. You remember the cave, the places of safety, safety hewn out of a stone so that people could have a place where they could rest and be careful. You remember the pillow in our story earlier. It doesn't really seem like a pillow, but we can be people that provide rest and assurance for people. We can be a stone where people can come to find coolness and relief from the heat of the day. We can use our stones so that others can have stepping places, safe places where they can go to find safety, as if big stones in the water, giving them a passageway across these winds and waves and waters that hit us. We, in invite you to think about how you want to be present with each other, how you want to be more and more available to each other, how you don't want to be stumbling blocks or weight that holds people down, but you want to set people free. You want to honor and cherish people. Please pray with us. Holy One, this is a complicated day, Father's Day, with misgivings, with separation, with grief. And this is also a day when we can honor and cherish the people who have gone before us, who showed us the way, who cleared the path for us, who taught us with lessons of love, sometimes easy, sometimes hard lessons of love and family and connection. Negative learning, still learning. Oh God, help us to be lifelong learners, to continue to receive our stories from the past, to find meaning and purpose for them, to let go of the ones that hinder us and hold us back and weigh us down and crush us, and instead to adopt, to inherit, to intentionally choose other stories, maybe from the scriptures that give us a hope and a future and possibility, and that align us with your ways of mystery, your ways of grace, your ways of belonging, weaving us together. God, hear us as we pray, each of us, as we pray aloud or silently about people who are stuck, people who are broken, people who have been tripped up, people who have been set aside for stoning, people who have been mistreated. And as we pray our prayers for the joys that have been ours and that continue to be ours, as we connect with each other, as we reach out our hand to each other, as we do work together, as we imagine who we can be alone and together, how it is that we are fashioned as miracles, and that possibilities come even when we think things are impossible. And so, God, move in our stories. Help us to have a new sense of belonging, a new sense of mastery and competency and gifts to help bring about your vision and your dreams for healing and refreshment and peace and justice and joy. God, as you hear us praying in our various ways, as you hear each of our stories coming to pass, as you hear us lifting up the stories of one another so that there will be more light and more warmth and more grace and more peace surrounding and moving through their stories, help us to rely again on the Jesus who taught us, including when he taught us how to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And so, as we've been saying, we have opportunities, we have responsibilities to set each other free, to unburden others, to meet their hungers and their thirsts, to be with them in places where they have been subjected to violence, to be with people when there's a new day, when there are fresh possibilities, when there is peace on the horizon, when they need a place to rest, when they need a place to be inspired, when they need a place to gather their stamina and their strength for what is next. And so we invite you to have that spirit of hospitality and generosity, to find old and new ways to be generous with your time, with your words, with your spirit. And we invite you to pray our prayer of dedication, knowing that we are called to be gift givers. Holy One, it's a small gesture, pulling coins or bills out of our pockets, writing a check, arranging for our bank to send our offering. It almost makes no sound as it drops into the offering plate, but it is the act of our hearts opening, giving you the fruit of our labor. It is our collective offering of love, a weekly deposit in the account of your faithfulness. We do this in the name of Jesus, who taught us how to care and share. Amen.
Thank you.
this place, may we be filled with the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the comfort and reassurances of the Holy Spirit, so that those gifts may find home in us, so that those gifts are part of our story, so that those gifts are part of what we say and what we do as we move out into the world. Go in love, go in peace, go in reassurance. We strive for limitless love, courageous action, and spirited inquiry. We offer warm blessings to Virginia and Roger Fagerberg as they celebrate their 61st wedding anniversary today. And we celebrate a birthday today, 21, yikes, for our older son, Tavis. We sent out to you an opportunity list for the things that are happening in the life of the church and through the church next week. If you didn't receive that, we're happy to send that along to you. On Wednesday evenings, we have a midweek meditation that goes up at 5 p.m. This week's theme is about welcome and inclusion, again, as we celebrate Pride Month. There's an opportunity to go to Grant's Farms here in St. Louis. If you are interested on Friday, please RSVP. We have a limited number of spots because of their new reservation process because of the pandemic. We continue to invite your participation as we support the good work that happens through Isaiah 58 Ministries in St. Louis City. There are opportunities to buy school supplies, to provide socks and underwear of all sizes for kids going back to school. There's a back-to-school carnival at the end of July, and we will be a part of that. We'll provide some games, and we'll be a part of a festivity with the families in the area. There are also opportunities to go to the Art Museum, the World Bird Sanctuary, or Cardinals game, the Muni. We're trying to do outdoor things together this summer. We have our book groups that continue through the summer. We hope that you might jump on board with those. For your prayers today, we are, of course, thinking about Father's Day and how it is a source of great joy for some and a source of grief or pain for others. In page 15 of your bulletin, there's an opportunity to think through a little bit more about grief. We're celebrating still Juneteenth from yesterday. We'll talk more about that in the future. And we are inviting you to be in prayer for Gail Haggard, who is transitioning, settling in at Laclede Groves Independent Living. His information, if you want to reach out to him, is in your bulletin. Martoma, the congregation that worships across the street, is welcoming a new Achen, a new pastor. His name is Thomas Matthew. He's coming from India. He'll be on a 3-year visit here. For the first time, Martoma is having their pastor live in St. Louis. The Achen that comes from India is in charge of a couple of congregations, at least, across the country. And so this is the first time that the Achen will live here in St. Louis. And our friends, our siblings at Martoma are delighted, and we'll have more opportunities to interact with him and the congregation. We're thinking about Marv Herpel as his daughter George's memorial service took place this past week. We're thinking about Polly and Mike Rutherford as they plan Polly's mother's memorial service that will take place here later this summer. Ellie Spenson is home recuperating from knee replacement surgery. Dan Weiss is having his cancer treatments beginning. We're thinking about Marcia Peake, who was going to be our second reader of stories today. Her 95-year-old mother, Norma, took a fall yesterday and has a broken hip and a broken shoulder and other struggles. And so we're thinking about Norma and Marcia and the rest of the family as they make decisions about Norma's care and her comfort. We're thinking about Rochelle Smith and family and the St. Louis University family. Some of you remember Jonathan Smith, who was with us last year during Black History Month, who gave us a powerful message and had a very interesting, impactful, inspirational adult education series with us. Unfortunately, Jonathan had a stroke last week and was recuperating, doing well, but did end up dying yesterday. And so we're thinking about Jonathan's family, and we're thinking about the SLU family, as he was very integral to the work that they do, especially around diversity and inclusion there at SLU. We continue to have our care team available if you have any needs during this time of pandemic or otherwise. We are delighted to be of support to you, and we are especially interested in helping people get vaccines if they have not done so already. Our St. Louis Association Covenant Partner of this past week has been Kirkwood UCC, and this coming week is Carondelet UCC. Next Sunday, we will have another Facebook Live worship service. Afterwards, we will have adult education on Zoom. It's called COVID Tales. There's more information in your bulletin and your weekly email. Richard Shearer, who pulls together our speaker series, thinks that it would be a good idea, and I agree with him, to hear your tales, your stories about this time of pandemic, things that you've learned, things that have been a struggle, movements of the Spirit during this time, ways that you have relied on each other, ways that you have learned about yourself or family members or the community, all kinds of opportunities that we might have to share those stories next week. The following Sunday, the 4th of July, we will have a pre-recorded YouTube service. July 11th will be our outdoor worship service, the second Sunday of the month. And then July 18th, we'll be back indoors for the first time. July 18th, we'll be here in the sanctuary. Many more details about that will be coming forth after the 4th of July. Again, thank you for choosing to be with us as we worship, as we listen, as we long to be a part of what God is about to do next.